So, thanks for coming on this Saturday morning at ADE, which probably still feels like Friday night to some people, and I know that for a fact for some people in the room. Name and no names, friends. So, what we're going to do today, we're going to break down what I consider to be what you would call a progressive techno track. So what I mean by that, just to be completely clear, I'm probably a lot older than you might think. My youthful looks tell a lie, because I am closer to 40 than I am 30. And I'm basically an old prog boy. I come from a time when, you know, Sasha was the number one DJ in the world and, you know, that kind of thing. And I love that melodic sound, and it's really exciting to me that that's coming back into techno particularly. And the way it's manifesting through artists, specifically like Enrico San Giuliano. And this is kind of a bit of an amalgamation of a few things I've done recently, including breaking down Enrico tracks and using them as inspiration and showing some of the tricks and sound design and also musicality tricks that you can use in order to get that kind of feel. So it's going to be quite a wide ranging exploration into a few different elements around this sound. I mean, I've done one masterclass already on kick and bass. So I'm not going to spend a lot of time on kick drums or on bass lines and stuff like that, but I will kind of, you know, give you a little kind of a tour through that. But we're going to focus mostly on the sound design and the melodic elements of how to get really on-point melodies and get the emotion into a techno production. Because without sort of going too off the deep end and getting too controversial about it, I, over breakfast this morning, decided to take a little skip through the Beatport techno section. Wow. There's an hour of my life I'm never going to get back. It was brutal, if I'm being completely honest with you, because, you know, it just sounded like the same record over and over again for an extended period of time. Oh, look, there's a kick drum with a reverb on it. Oh look, there's a donk. Oh look, there's a complete lack of feel and emotion in the music, which I think is something that needs to be addressed quite quickly. And we're going to hopefully do that this morning. So the reason why I kind of go towards producers like Enrico is that he's one of those people who is trying to do something different. And if you listen to his album that was recently released on Drum Code, It was a nice departure for Drum Code to actually do something that did have something of a deeper meaning to it. And you listen to particularly the track that I've done breakdowns of this track last week in London, so I'm not going to spend too much time actually like going through the track itself. But if you listen to tracks like Hidden Tea, for example, that has, you know, something more to it. It has something a bit more melodic to it. And it straddles a divide where, if you think about, obviously I referenced Sasha, you can think about DJs like Sasha, John Digweed, the big progressive names probably playing an Enrico track, as well as the big techno names like your Adam Beyers and everyone else. Yeah, you know, your Alan Fitzpatrick's, if you will. So it allows you to kind of straddle a bit of a divide of genres. So you can sit in the middle and it broadens your appeal as an artist. And I do think this sound is getting bigger and bigger. And I think we're going to start looking for something a bit more musical, because I think we've had, you know, enough time over the last three or so years of just non-stop warehouse pounders. You know, I think it's time to bring some emotion into it. So the main thing we're going to go through is we're going to look at like the main sort of breakdown in this track. And I'm just going to sort of go through a few little techniques where that's concerned and blend in a little bit of sound design into it as well. So again, what the aim is not in this case, we're not talking about actually trying to recreate things exactly. We're not trying to duplicate things. We're not, you know, trying to, you know, add to the noise that's already out there. We're going to use this, and you'll see how I use artists like this as a way of them being a signpost for a more inspired way of working. I use reference tracks all the time, but I use them very differently to a lot of people. I use them more predominantly as I say, a signpost, and I'm not trying to emulate. I'm trying to use them as a guide towards where I want to get to. And then when I get there, it's then about how do I explore how I can take this even further. So we can do that in that spirit today. So I'm just going to play an excerpt of the breakdown, and then we'll get to it. I'm not going to let that drop. Because you always leave people wanting more, don't you? You know? Nothing funnier than people falling off the edge. Anyway. So, what I'm going to do is I'm going to isolate a little section of this. And maybe just down to a couple of bars. And let's say, for example, you're interested in, obviously, the texture of the sound that is expressing that sort of emotional context. But you're quite interested in what kind of notes are being used. Okay, so this is one way of going about it, and this is something I like to do. And this also highlights just how important it is. In fact, I'm just going to take 115 to 117 here. This actually highlights the importance of, if you're going to write arpeggiated lines like this, it's actually really important that you write them manually or you have access to the raw note data. So obviously we have sequences within certain synths, or we have the use of arpeggiators in various different ways, and they can very quickly get some very good results. But if they're interacted with in the normal way, you don't necessarily get access to every part of what makes that sound great and be able to then further manipulate the musicality or the music composition, if you will, in order to take it a stage further and add variation. We're going to look at that in quite a few different ways this afternoon, I should say. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take this little two bar section. So what we're going to do is we're going to crop that sample, because as you know, if you separate something like this, it just gives you like a little loop. It's like a little region, a clip, if you will. So I'm going to right click and I'm going to crop the clip. Now the reason why I'm going to crop the clip down to just this two bars is because we're going to use Ableton's audio to MIDI engine in order to actually get a rough estimation of what notes are being used. Okay, now I'm sure some of you guys may have used this before if Ableton is your DAW, and you know for a fact that sometimes it's bang on point, other times it's a complete shit show. It's like, are you even listening to the same track? You know, it can be really bad. But a lot of the time it's somewhere in the middle, and what you find a lot of the time is that you can actually help Ableton to do something a lot more accurately by just something as simple as, I want to crop that two bar section because it's the same notes all the way through. So why analyze the entire track when you can just take, and there's a reason why I've taken this section here, is because it's very clear. The notes and the pitches are very, very clear. Okay, so I've got this two bar loop, so therefore it gives Ableton a little less to think about. Okay, but on top of that, what we're going to do is we're going to give Ableton a few more hints, because I'm going to take the grid to a 16th. Okay, now what you can probably see here is that the clips or the actual notes, they're roughly in line with the 16th here. Okay, so what will happen here is you can actually use the little transient markers here to create warp markers, and actually within the context of the audio to MIDI engine, what you're actually doing is telling Ableton that's where a note is. So you're helping it with the detection, and then you can actually get to a more accurate result. So I'm going to hold command, and you can see I can put three warp markers in at once. And you can see they roughly come down every sort of 16th note. And this, just over two bars, and again, it's fairly simple. I can be fairly rough with it because it is every 16th, pretty much, with a gap. What I'm now going to do is take this, I'm just going to give this a slightly different colour, and then, is that on? Oh, thank fuck for that. It's not as yellow. Right, so, from there, I'm going to now select here. You've got three options with the audio to MIDI engine, if you don't already know. You've got Convert Harmony, which would actually look at that underlying chord progression of the bass line, which is actually, if you listen to the track and analyze the movement of the musicality, what's happening is that the emotion, a lot of it is actually coming from the bass line shifting up and down on top or underneath the arp, and the arp is just cycling. So it changes the context and it changes the perspective of the arp, but the arp doesn't really change. What does change within the arp is obviously the filters and the envelopes and the lengths and the decays of each sound. You can also do what we're about to do, which is convert the melody, which will look predominantly at that arp. So all it is, it's more to do with frequencies more than anything. It'll try and look at the higher sounds, essentially the higher frequency sounds. And also as well, what can be quite useful if you like the groove of a particular drum pattern or, you know, part of a track, you can actually do convert drums. So if you get a clean loop at the beginning of a track and you just like the feel and the rhythm of it, the audio to MIDI engine will actually do a conversion of kick, snare and hi-hat as well, which can be quite useful. But we're going to go for melody and let's see what it spits out, because to be honest with you, I've done it on this track before and it's been roughly accurate, and I've done it on another occasion with the same track and it can be completely different. So let's see what mood Ableton's in today. I mean, it's been at ADE all week, so it might just have a hangover or some form of come down, who knows. So, as you can see, it's converting, it's having a little think about it. And what it's now done is that it's dropped a brand new channel with a MIDI region in. And what it does is that it gives a synth, a melody to MIDI synth. Now, if those of you who have done this process before, if you remember it, this synth is goddamn the most awful sounding thing imaginable. But it's that way for a reason, because it gives you incredibly clear pitch. So what it does is it allows you to actually run this channel with the MIDI parallel to the reference track, so then you can actually hear how accurate the conversion's actually been. I mean, you can even just listen to it now. I'm going to turn it down a little bit because it is a little bit jarring, but I mean, it's basically just jazz, essentially. But what you can hear, if you listen through, like there, and then, okay. So it's in there somewhere. You just have to do a little bit of polishing and a little bit of cleaning up. So what we're going to do is exactly that process. So if we listen to that in comparison, you can see there, we could actually just take that right there, and then essentially that is your pattern. So it's actually identified all the correct notes, it's just the order's a bit garbled. Okay, so very quickly, if you know where to look and actually listen to it and cycle through it a few times, you'll be able to get to a point where actually that is the loop. So what I'll be able to do then is just polish this up a little bit. I can then quantize it to the 16th. Everything tightens up. I can get rid of these little notes. And effectively, what I've got now is, and then it's in there somewhere. And you can hear it's slightly long or slightly short, so it's cycling slightly differently because it's a weird thing. It's like a beat in a 16th note. So what we'll be able to do then is maybe just lengthen that out a little bit. There you go. an extra 16th note. So now we're in business. So I'm going to take those notes and I'm just going to standardize them. And again, I'm just going to crop the clip because the rest of it is just, you know, garbage now. And now I've got... I mean, it's slightly off on the sequence, but the actual feel of it is there. So now we get an understanding of what kind of progression is there. So that can be super useful for actually writing your own arps. And again, what you've got from here, because you've got the ability to, say, duplicate the loop, you can then start to make this into, say, for example, a 6. Maybe you can cut that at an 8-bar loop. Loop that. Crop it again. At 8 bars. And again, it'll cycle in an interesting way because it's 5/16th notes. There's 5 notes there with a 6th little gap that you could put a note in there if you wanted to, but you could then change it if you wanted to and change this up. This is where you start to depart from the reference and you start to get into really interesting territory. You can then obviously get, this is more of like a polyrhythm because it's not in a 4/4 time signature. So you'll get interested in little cycles as you just heard in comparison. So this is where, again, you start to take it in your own direction. Now, the power of actually working this way and actually being able to... Right, we've got 2 there. There we go. We can then just duplicate that to... There you go. So you can see you've got like that little extra little movement, but now you've got access to every single note. You could start to take little sections of this and start to say, well, actually, at the end of bar 4 and bar 5, I want it to go like this. So it varies and it comes off the constantly repeated thing. So if you were actually just working with an arpeggiator where you were just holding keys down, you couldn't do that. Or actually sequencing that on board on a synth is actually a little bit more labor intensive and you don't really get into the raw MIDI data. Now, some of the other things you can do, say for example, is if I also, because again from here what I would do, I'd actually get rid of this god-awful synth, so don't worry, you don't have to listen to that anymore. You know, it's a bit painful enough as it is. I can then start to look at using different tools. So, say for example, I drop in a Repro 1, which is one of my favourite synths, by Yuhi. Phenomenal sounding synth. And then, you know, there is actually arpeggio presets built in, and one of my favourite ones is actually something like this, Berlin School Tubular. And if we were to just play that... Nice tone to it. And again, the notes are quite high here, so again what you could start to do is maybe take that off fold and then we can drop it an octave. Now you've heard that higher level now, that we can start to get into some really interesting sound design here. Now what you'll get over the 8, if I just, I'll do 4 even, you'll hear that little variation. Yeah, I can just take that little top note and just completely flick it into a different thing. And if I wanted to get a lot more dramatic, I could actually take a section. Say, for example, if we were to do 8 bars, take the end of that 8th bar, the last 2 beats, and you've got these other MIDI tools that are quite useful. You've got reverse. And as you can see, it basically takes the sequence and it reverses it. So the MIDI notes effectively play in reverse order. So you'll get something like this. And sometimes it works, and sometimes it's a bit skippy like that, but then that kind of gives you an... oh, hang on, there's a bit of an idea there. You know, I could actually play around with that a little bit. You know, maybe we replay the last bar a few times. So maybe that can come up an octave, shift up. There's a little gap there, actually. Just put this away. go. And if you play that as a full 8-bar sequence, we're already starting to take what Enrico's done and we're starting to do our own thing with it, you know? So again, we're using it as a jumping off point and we're actually getting maybe even more emotion out of this. And again, you couple that with some automation. And some other elements that we can start to use. So say, for example, the next thing we could do is start to duplicate. And then, let's say, for example, we take this and then roll it down another octave. So you've got multiple layers of the same synth. And then this top layer could actually come up an octave. And then each one can have their own automations. Different sends out to different reverbs and delays, and then the three layers can just be constantly in motion, and you can really start to get a really nice dense and quite powerful sequence where actually when we started this a few minutes ago, actually the one synth sounded great, and then you just stack and you stack from there, and then you can get into resampling and send effects and stuff, which we'll get into now. So in order to really extend the musicality and extend the scale of these sounds, send effects become really, really important. So I have, again, for those of you who've seen my masterclasses before, you'll know I have this kind of like toolbox of sounds. Effectively, my sound as an artist lives in these folders. And I've got everything down from, say, for example, drum racks and synth presets that I'll use across multiple productions. I've got those saved right the way down to even reverbs, delays, things like that. And you're probably laughing at some of the stupid names of some of my stuff here. I can hear laughed. Donald Thump is probably the one that's making people laugh. Anyway, less about that, the better. So basically what I've got here is a rather large reverb, which I tend to use more as like a, it's almost like a reactive kind of like synth pad. And you can probably see by the settings here, it's 16.3 seconds, so it's a pretty big reverb, you know? But I'm controlling it with a kickstart, just to give a little bit of rhythm. But I'm also rolling off before the signals arrive at the reverb. We're actually rolling off everything from about 600 hertz down. So we're not going to break that cardinal rule of music production or dance music production, which is don't feed too much low end into a reverb, because you're going to get more of whatever you give it, and then it's going to really muddy up and overwhelm your bottom end, and you don't want that. This is set up in such a way where I can even just leave a sub bass with it sent all the way, and then when I decide to roll the filter to, you know, let out the sawtooth wave, for example, it will catch the top end of the synth, and it'll really react with the reverb. So you'll hear this on send A. So if I just go to this one here, and then just send it. Get this lovely washing pad that really adds to the scale of it, and again you can add all three layers to that as well. Another nice little trick as well is with automation, where if I was to throw into our automation mode here, another thing I like to do, I'm just going to swap this delay out, and I love echo, which was a new addition in Live 10. I love this so much because you can do really, really cool stuff with it. And what you can actually do is take, let's say, for example, that lovely little reversal that we did before, we could actually just send that to the delay that's for A. So we need B. Just send that to B. I hear that extra little movement there. And we can shape the filter on the echo. So if we were just to take those last two bars. And then move back to the echo. As you want to build, you can then increase the feedback. And it distorts beautifully. So we're getting a huge amount of emotion out of these parts now. And again, even just using things like envelope amount just to brighten and make the sound a bit more plucky. So yeah, we're into some really interesting stuff here. And again, automation on send effects can be really important as well. So what I quite like to do is that I like to take echo and delay plugins like it and delays in general, I like to take them out of the note sync mode, although that's quite pleasant. What you can actually do by being quite clever with calculating delay times is you can actually just offset the delay time a little bit to add a bit of groove. So obviously, you can do that with the offsets here. Oh, thank you. Oh, it's a bit early, but, you know, I'll tag one on. It's been a long week. I can use this little offset here, but you can get really satisfying things by actually being quite rough with the delay time. And, you know, we're not going to get the calculators out to calculate the delay times, but I do like doing that, actually. It's quite a useful thing, because if you think back to the days of, like, you know, dub producers who were using tape delays or using tape machines for delays, they never had, like, oh, I'll just put that on a 1/8 dotted, great, 56% feedback. They're like, and they're trying to, like, they calculated themselves, you know, and they do it by ear and they do it by sight almost as well. So it's well worth actually doing that, because it adds a little bit of, like, non-linear interest to it. And you can do things like this where, let's say, for example, we just keep that going. So, you know, you get some really interesting things out of it. And again, you can actually hear the pitch of it changing. And that's because old school delays, like tape delays, work very much like a turntable, like a vinyl turntable, like a Technics, where the actual speed or the actual delay time in this case is linked to the playback pitch. So the shorter the time is, the shorter the delay time is, the higher the pitch goes. So you can use that to your advantage by creating these, like, almost like pitch bent kind of like builds. But then you can also turn that off if you want. And this is the beauty of having a plugin that is kind of emulating what a piece of hardware would do. But then you can kind of play with the rules a little bit. So you can get something a bit more structured. So the pitch won't change now, but you can still do this great. feel like a bit like the guitar solo in Wayne's World. Stop it, Paul. There's no stairway to heaven, especially with an echo plugin. So you can do all of these really interesting things where, you know, you get all these lovely texts, and you hear these a lot in productions. So let's like move this on a stage in order to go into, say, for example, some resampling. So what I would do in this case, I want to be able to isolate the sound of that into an audio file that I can then blend or place underneath a track. So how I do that is using resampling. So let's say, for example, we grab a track here and we call that resampling. So I always have a resampling track. And as you can see, the input here is set to resampling. If you're not familiar with it, what it means is that anything that's playing through the master will be recorded into an audio file, essentially, or be seen at this input. So what I can do is drop these MIDIs out. And actually, what I'll do is I'll solo the return. So I'll solo echo on B. And you can hear here that actually that now, there you go. So you get these little shots, right? Because it's only sending every little bit or so. So what I can actually do here is use that to my advantage. And say, for example, if I start recording here, this will now record this into an audio file. Okay. So then if I start playing around with it, it's going to give me what I want. Even though I've just stopped the clip, that will continue to record with this lovely long feedback. Now I can go to echo. It's still recording. Add more reverb because it's got an inbuilt reverb. Stop. There you go. And then you've got that as something that you can then place in an arrangement, or you can then subject it to further sound design, which is, guess what we're going to do? Of course we are. Of course we're going to screw it up even further, because that's what we're here for. So what we can do here is take a section of it. You can hear I've got a couple of tools on it. I'm just going to turn these off, little overhangs from previous. So if I play that as a little, or even here where it's like really, you can use this as a loop. Now you might not believe me, but one of the things you can do here, I'm a really big fan in Ableton of like deliberately warping things really badly and really wrong. Well, wrong. You get what I mean. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take it out of complex mode and I'm going to put it into beats, which is interesting because this is not beats material. One of the things I would encourage you to do is experiment with the different warp modes when you're working with the audio, and always think about printing your synth plugins into audio, because then you've committed. But on top of that, you are minimizing the risk of anything happening during a production, which settings change and synths start misbehaving and, you know, they tend to go awry. I've had whole productions lost to that type of stuff. So when you get a sound, print it, you know, get hold of it, resample it, you know, freeze it, drop it to a new audio track, do whatever you need to do. But we can take it a bit further here where we're in beats. And if I look at the preserve section here, this is set up for preserving drum transients. However, what I can do is I can actually set it to preserve 16th notes. So this will now break the signal up into 16th note chunks. I can then determine how those 16th notes are looped if I'm stretching them quite a lot. So if I look at these three arrows here, I can either have that 16th note play forwards and backwards in order to make up for any stretches, any, like, you know, gaps in the audio file, or I can have them here, this middle one here, just loop forward and forward over again, which will give you like a bit of a glitch. It's a bit of like a granular kind of quality. But this one here is of particular interest because it's just going to play the 16th note chunks and then just stop. It's not going to do anything else. It's not going to try and make up for any perceived gaps. So if I do that, and if I manipulate this little control here, this is like a fade. It's almost like a like an envelope for the 16th note. So what you'll hear is this. Sounds totally fine. Sounds totally normal. However, ladies and gentlemen, we've hit that time where we feel like we need to have a kick drum underneath something. And it's normally about now. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to drop that there. And I'm going to open a drum rack up. And again, we can activate kickstart for a little sidechain. And what's great now is that we can take that delay and we can drop it down an octave. So we're taking inspiration from an amazing artist, taking the musicality, working out what the original artist has composed, stacking that on top, taking it further, and then further pushing this sound by resampling our own sounds and our own jams with live effects in order to create entirely new textures which form the basis of an entirely new, quite musical, quite epic, and quite meaningful production. So just to close for like the last sort of 10 minutes or so, the last 8 minutes or so that I've got, I want to just talk about going back to MIDI, so the thing coming full circle. So what we can do here, I've got another Repro One here with the same setting. And I was just jamming around with this particular setting before we started. And even just using the, you know, computer keyboard in Ableton, I was able with this Berlin School Tubular preset, what you can do is you can set this into a re-trigger mode. And say, for example, I was just like hitting a little riff like this. If I just soloed that. Right, okay, I'm not getting any MIDI, which is always useful. MIDI for, oh, that's why. Okay. Ballins. There you go. So you can hear there that it's just like a, you know, a single hit sound. Now if I hit all three of those, I'm just playing three notes. That's just like a very simple kind of art. Now if I started playing keys, other notes that I want to be able to play, but the problem is that if I record that straight in with a, yeah, it's not even in time, and you can just see in the background there all I'm getting is the three notes that I'm holding, so I've got no control over that sequence whatsoever. I can obviously change when that sequence is being played and what keys trigger it, but actually, pretty useless. However, if you think about the pattern, what's actually happening, you can see here the ARP is set to up. So it's basically just playing the note in an upward order. So if we go to what we would normally do, we'd normally go to MIDI effects, drop an arpeggiator, set that to a 16th note, just going to turn that. Is that sequence off already? It is. And then I can play the same thing. But the problem is, if I record that, I'm going to get just the three notes again. So this is the way around it. And this is where you get some really interesting variation. I always have, in a lot of these productions when I'm composing, I'll always have an ARP / MIDI effects channel. So my MIDI is actually originating from somewhere else. So this is a blank MIDI track. It has no instrument in. Its purpose is to be connected. The other way that wasn't playing initially is because I wasn't playing from the right channel. So all I have to do now is go to right. MIDI from, in the channel I want to trigger, ARP / MIDI. Arm and solo, both channels. And now if I play from here, it's the same, but I've got little variations going on. Now if I hit hold and let it go, so what I'm going to do is hit record here. Okay, in fact. So, interesting, right? Because now we've got all of this variation. I mean, if you imagine having to sit there and do that a note at a time. I mean, I'm bored just thinking about it. But if I go to the ARP and MIDI channel, the reason why I've been able to get the raw MIDI like that is because it's being received from another channel. So you've almost triggered the arpeggio from a stage back in the process, which means when you hit record on the actual synth channel, it's seeing the arpeggiated MIDI rather than it being generated within the arpeggiator before the synth in the channel itself, if that makes sense. So I've got various MIDI tools. So I've got pitch, which means I can just take the whole sequence and lift it by certain intervals, octaves, up, down, whatever. The ARP is just, again, up, 16th notes, nothing too complicated. I haven't actually changed anything really apart from hit hold and just change it to a 16th note. Now the randomizer is interesting because it's set to 21% chance of change. I've got it on random with the choice of taking a note and moving it up and down an octave, as in 12 notes here in this middle one, choices 12. Scale set to 1, which means it'll only do it over one octave. And the signature is actually set to add, which means it's only going to take notes and raise them rather than drop them. So you can set it to drop, or you can set it to do both if you want. You get different results. Now, what's stopping that, if you listen to all of those notes, what's stopping that from actually sounding completely off key and just wonky as anything? Because this will just spit out random notes. The randomizer, like, does not give a shit about keys, scales, emotions. It just does its job. However, the scale plugin is there to do that job. So what this is actually doing is taking notes it's seeing that's clearly out of, in this case, believe it or not, that's a C major scale. You know, it's the most boring scale you've got, but actually it sounds quite emotional here because of all these little ornaments and little movements that this randomizer's created. And what it's doing is taking any notes that's outside the C major and going, actually, you belong down here. Or actually, you belong here, or you belong up here. So it takes it and it's almost quantizing the notes to the next available or appropriate note in a C major scale. So it means that you could literally just leave that for, you know, I could go to the bathroom and come back in 5 minutes and it's still spitting out perfect notes. There's no such thing as a mistake at that point. You're just down to jamming with different keys to get different feels. So now, I've got this wonderful, really, you know, evocative synth line. And all I'm doing is basically holding three keys on the keyboard. Or playing, you know, again, I could play just whole things straight in. It doesn't have to be, you know, particularly complicated. I could actually take the randomizer and that off. I could play this through again. because I've got a bit more of a structured riff. So you get the idea from there. And basically I can then take the higher notes and maybe even raise those up again by, again, taking the note and then manually moving them up and down as well. So you've got that approach of, I'm going to record in something deliberate. I now have the raw MIDI. I can then manipulate it. Or I've got this beautiful randomized thing. And you create these beautiful builds in these techno productions that really make these breakdowns. Idea, because with this style, to close with this style, the musicality is really, really important, and obviously the sound design and everything else is, but a lot of what these types of productions, like Enrico, what they come down to, it comes down to the music composition more than anything. So you could even play, and you heard it with that awful melody to MIDI synth, even though it was playing the right notes with an awful sound, the emotion was still there. The emotion is in the notes. So if you start to really experiment and, again, allow some randomization to come in and use the MIDI tool to your advantage and have a little knowledge of the signal flow in Ableton, as well as all these lovely layerings and resamplings and stuff, in no time at all, you're going to be able to really, really increase the scale, the emotion, the storytelling, and the meaning in, again, as we said before, with, you know, a lot of techno, it's quite, unfortunately, it's starting to sound a little bit empty. It's starting to sound a little bit hollow. So hopefully you've gotten something from that today. Hopefully that is going to really help you in your productions. I haven't been given the wind-up notice yet, so is there a quick question before we finish? I may have time for one quick question. Yes? Oh, dude, that's a whole other masterclass in itself, like... I mean, I'm actually doing a whole online course just on arrangements at the moment. And yeah, I mean, it's an art form in and of itself. Yeah. Yeah. And different approaches are completely appropriate depending upon the time. You know, I mean, I'm very big on using the session view in order to effectively sketch the skeleton of the track out, and then refining it in the arrangements afterwards. But I'm finding recently that my own productions, on a couple of cases, I've decided to do it what I would call like the old school way, which is like lay it out, you know, in an arrangement view and not really use the session view too much. But it depends on what kind of effect you're trying to get. With a lot of techno, I mean, obviously with the fact that it's quite drum-led, you could probably use the session view quite efficiently to get the meat of it down, and then the refinement that you were talking about, that's where you would do that work in the arrangement view. I would say with arrangement, the number one thing I would say as a quick tip is that actually what matters more is the order that you do things in. So say, for example, I always structure the track without any automation first. The only bit of automation I'll do is removing the bass from a kick drum in order to create a marker for like a breakdown or like a pause before a drop. What after that, I only do the automation as almost like one of the final things. So it gives you a context so you know exactly where you need to raise that synth cutoff or send that, you know, arpeggio to a delay. Yeah. And that's, again, that's much later in the process. Because then what it allows you to do when you're structuring the track as almost like an automationless skeleton, it means that it forces you to make the track sound as good as possible without relying on automation. And actually, one of the rules that I kind of follow is that this has to work as a piece of music in its default state. It has to be exciting. So whatever I do to automate or to send off to reverbs or delays, it's an enhancement of a track that's already exciting. Yeah. Exactly. You're taking something that's already exciting by its raw arrangement and making it like, oh, Jesus Christ, like, you know, my fingernails are digging into the desk, you know? That kind of thing. So think about it in those kinds of terms. And I've found a lot of the best producers kind of do it that way. And again, don't discount actually, after I do the full arrangement, the automation is all done on controllers. So it's live. So I'm adding in a live element. It's not like incredibly clean curves all the time, you know? Because again, you know, I make the joke, a lot of people make music the way I do my taxes. You know? It's just so like, the lines are here and it's just all straight, you know? And it's like, you wonder why your music's boring, because there's absolutely no humanity in it, you know? Like, introduce randomness, knock things off the groove, do weird things with controllers that, you know, make it clear that you've performed over the top of this arrangement. It's not fucking techno Tetris. Do you know what I mean? It's not dance music Lego, you know? It is literally you're trying to express yourself. So express yourself, you know? Any final questions before I come up with anything more embarrassing? No? Well, on that awkward note, I'll finish. Thanks very much, guys. Appreciate it.